So I invite Dr. Bansidhar Tharai to cruise us through this topic, Early Diagnosis of Sepsis, Mission Possible. Dr. Bansidhar Tharai is a senior consultant microbiologist at Max Super Speciality Hospital, New Delhi. He is also the coordinator for microbiologic services offered across Max Hospitals of Delhi. He is a recipient of several prestigious awards, an active member of Hospital Infection Control Society, and so I request him to begin his talk.
Okay. Thank you to JPM. What a wonderful session, Madam Dr. Burgess. And so I know it is a microbiology. Most of hello.
This is forward.
Okay.
And this is backward. Second one backward.
This one is backward.
This one also pointer, but ये चल नहीं रहा है तो ये use करना है.
Not a problem. So I know microbiology. I think most of our pathologists. So I will not take much time, but I know lot of laboratory pathology practitioners. They have a microbiology instruments, and often they are not able to utilize that instruments. What I am discuss from the background. So in microbiology we have one is that most important is the sepsis, and we know sepsis almost 30 million cases of sepsis occurs each year. And if we will not initially intervene the diagnosis as well as the management, I think in each hour of early diagnosis is very, very important. Within 7.6% of increased mortality if we lose the patients to diagnose or give the antibiotic at the earliest. And most of the time the sepsis is mainly because of from the intravascular devices or from urinary tract infections or from the pneumonia or the intra-abdominal infections. This accounts almost 60% of the sepsis, and rest of the cases mostly we are not able to diagnose the cases of sepsis. And blood culture still is the gold standard, is the diagnostic choice. And sensitivity of blood cultures even varies depending on the source of the infections. And important is that we have come across lot of challenges when we are collecting the blood cultures. So in our hospitals, what we practice is that we practice paired blood cultures, means two bottles, one from left, one from right, so that we are able to diagnose or increase the sensitivity of blood cultures. And deliberately, in fact, in our hospitals, we have kept the price, both are same for single blood culture as well as the paired blood culture, so that clinicians will send paired blood culture more. And I have two studies from my hospitals where we have seen almost double the sensitivity of blood culture positive. And what especially the laboratory, what we feel is that most of the times they send single blood cultures of the blood volume, also the most important factor contributing the sensitivity of blood cultures. The blood volume we received is less, and there is a time gap between sending the blood cultures to the lab and reaching from the patient side and to incubate the blood culture bottles. These all are challenges, how you prepare the skin before taking the blood cultures, or it is taken from catheter sides, or it is from the peripheral sides. All are important factors contributing the diagnosis of blood cultures. So what is the best time to collect the blood is the when you have a chills or the temperature. That time is the best time, but anytime you can take blood culture, not a problem. But the most important factor is that before starting any antibiotics, because that is the ideal time where you can get the maximum blood culture positive. But what of the most of the laboratory or the hospital setup, now they are getting the automated blood culture bottles, which they have resins also. They try to some extent neutralize the antibiotics, but best time is before starting any antibiotics. And the second most important is that volume. Why I am saying is that if you increase the volume, then the sensitivity of blood culture will be increased. The positivity percentage will increase. And ideal blood volume in adults is 8 to 10 mL what we received, but pediatrics it can be vary from neonates and to the pediatrics. And if you increase the blood volume, even some studies are there showing if you increase the blood volume from 10 to 20, 20 to 30, then 40, like even the paired blood culture, then sensitivity is almost increases. So what is defined by a SET? It is a SET is basically two blood cultures, two different sides, one from left, one from right, one from central line, one from periphery. And this is we require in almost all cases. However, in some cases like in endocarditis, or if there is a pyrexia of unknown origin, or in fungal sepsis, we ask for three sets of blood cultures, one from now, and then second set we repeat between 45 to 1 hour of taking the first sets, and then third blood culture set we recommend after 24 hours. And most of the time they discuss, we will send two aerobic bottles, aerobic anaerobic bottles, but you can send aerobic and anaerobic bottles that has little more increased sensitivity, but we practice aerobic and keep the anaerobic bottle in specific sites like in the neonates or in the surgical cases where there is a high chance of anaerobic infections. This is what I'm discussing is that if you increase the sets of blood culture, the sensitivity of blood cultures increases. And this is the timing when you collect the three sets of blood cultures. Another important factor is that when, especially in from ICU, if some of them are in from the hospital setups, what we take one from central line, one from peripheral line, and if the blood culture positive first in the central line 2 hours prior to the peripheral blood culture bottle, then most probably the source is the central line. So we try to remove the central line. This is one of the important criteria for intensivist. They ask which line comes positive first. Not only blood cultures, we can send other body fluids because all of them are sterile. You can send the sterile body fluid like CSF, pleural fluid or ascitic fluid. There will be definitely the increased sensitivity of the blood cultures. Now the most important point is what I am to discuss is that once the blood cultures come positive, now we do a gram stain and inform to the clinicians. This patient blood culture is growing something gram negative bacilli, so you can correlate or you can start antibiotics as per gram negative or gram positive. Because whatever we do, even from a clinical pathologist point of view, I'm a being microbiologist, I go rounds every day from morning 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock, interact with the clinicians. Whatever the best technology we have, what are the best report we send, but unless the report reaches to the clinicians, and does the clinicians interpret that report or the same report he utilized to the patients, that is now most important. There is a clinical pathological interactions which earlier was lacking. This is most important, and you have to build a trust, confident to the clinicians, that is, I care for your patients. Maybe automated has helped me to detect the diagnosis, but you have to interact, especially senior consultants, that yes, this is your reports, and this is the, and even as if you have microbiology, definitely I should discuss more of antibiotics, what is going on, what is a clinical diagnosis. These are the key factors, like the blood volume, I'm saying is that almost 8 to 10 ml is required for the adult patients, whereas child pediatric is up to 4 ml, and for neonate 0.5 to 1 ml is reported. And as quickly you send to the laboratory. These are the blood cultures. We have published the paired blood culture, single blood culture. Definitely, there is an increase in the sensitivity of paired blood cultures of true pathogens than the single pathogens. And this is the same things, these are newer data, so I will not go into details because of it is a more of microbiological point of view. Definitely, if you increase the blood culture volume and increase the blood culture bottle, definitely you will get more sensitivity results. I know he, most of the laboratory has now got these automated things, but how you will utilize this, apply to all patients, they should get the automated blood cultures bottles and utilize the positivity. In fact, in our hospital, we get positive almost all true pathogen within 16 hours incubations. And we have a 24/7 lab. Once the blood culture is positive, we incubate, and then the final reports within 24 hours we release. We have automated Vitek 2 in the night time. If they are in the growth, we process, especially for blood cultures, and the next day morning we release the reports. Even the same bottles, bacteria alert, we use the bacteria alert bottles. Even candida, you can see all fungi also in the same bottles, for the bacteria and fungi able to grow in the same bottles. So maximum positivity you can see within 90% positivity within 24 hours, and then subculture and incubation, and another almost think another 24 hours. This is the blood volume we received, almost 70% we received, or 7 to 8 ml. So once we diagnose, or the blood cultures help on diagnosis the sepsis, now most the next step is the identifications. Initially what we identify is by manually, but now the things are changed. Unless you identify the true pathogens, then you cannot treat. What I'm saying is that now lot of new organism has come, especially in from the ICU settings, because most of the laboratory, the pathologists head the laboratory medicine. So we have to understand that all organism, I don't know about sensitivity, but its identification is very, very important. If you are thinking of gram-negative, it may be coming Acinetobacter, and the Acinetobacter sensitivity pattern is totally different of E. coli. Or Burkholderia sepacea, a lot of new organism has come up, in the those are basically the nosocomial acquired bacteria. So we have to identify all bacteria by an automated instrument, what by especially in all hospital setups. Okay, urine from the community, as you can see, most of them are E. coli or Klebsiella, but in hospital setups, you have to identify the true pathogen because the sensitivity is totally different. Colistin or carbapenem is maybe effective for the Acinetobacter, but it's not effective for Burkholderia or Proteus. So organisms are totally different. You have to identify all organism. Then susceptibility as per the identifications of the organisms. We have a CLSI guidelines, the breakpoints, has the zone diameters. Every organism has separate antibiotic zone diameter, or the pattern of antibiotics, which antibiotic to be given. So most important is that you also utilize the instruments. The even we have a Vitek 2, we have to utilize. It is a MRSA or the ESBL patterns. If it is a MRSA, none of the antibiotics will work. Only 4 or 5 antibiotics will work. All cephalosporin or cephalosporin combination will not work. Even though in the zone diameter it is so, it is sensitive, but it will not effective in the patient management. Because it is MRSA, even also it is showing the sensitivity, we have to give the resistance. So lot of things has changed. ESBLs also similar things, or even the AMC detections, everything. I'll not go to about the MIC breakpoints or what the MIC interpretation to the clinicians, because this is a basically a purely a microbiological things. I'll not discuss, but what I can say is that antibiotics are not same for all. It is the E. coli antibiotics are not applicable for Acinetobacter. Acinetobacter antibiotics are not applicable for Burkholderia. You have to identify the organisms. I know most of them have advanced systems, but we have to utilize the identification or susceptibility testing. These are the ID results, and these are the sensitivity patterns. Most of the clinicians in the hospitals, especially tertiary care hospital, now they are asking for the MIC breakpoints. Which MIC is the lowest? Sometimes the meropenem may be sensitive, or imipenem may be sensitive. If the MIC of imipenem is lower, then definitely clinician will try that antibiotics. or the vancomycin, amycin, if the amycin is 2, even it is showing sensitivity, the clinician will not start antibiotic vancomycin. They preferably will change the antibiotics to torgocid or some other antibiotics, because the amycin is going to 2, definitely after 3 or 4 days that there will be a treatment failure. So amycin is also coming up, but yes, this is the second stage, but the first stage is the identification is very, very important nowadays. So all these points, now the third thing is that in the sepsis marker is the procalcitonin. I hope all the lab has the procalcitonin, but the interpretation is little important. And mainly procalcitonin are raised in the gram-negative bacteria. If you see the high procalcitonins, 50, 60, more than 15 or 20, it is more of a gram-negative sepsis. But the most important is that procalcitonin is a inflammatory marker. If you do a procalcitonin in the post-surgical, especially first initial 3 days of surgery, like in CTBS or neurosurgery, the procalcitonin definitely will increase. So we have to see when a clinician is sending the procalcitonin. And initially 3 days of post-surgical stress, the procalcitonin definitely will increase. But ideally, in your medical conditions or in a surgical conditions, the procalcitonin range is little different. And the procalcitonin level will be increased when there will be a severe sepsis or septic shock. So one thing it will say you, yes, if the value is high, the patient is a very severe shock. That can at least tell the which category of the patients now in which category of sepsis. And if it's a medical patients, even 2 or more than 2, we take as a cutoff for sepsis. Whereas in surgical patients, we preferably take a higher value cutoff, 5.7 or like between 2.6 to 8.4 is the cutoff for surgical patients. So all procalcitonin has to be correlated with the clinical conditions. This is also important. And this is not only help in the diagnosis, it also help in antibiotics. If the procalcitonin is definitely less than 2 or less than 0.25, definitely it is not sepsis. What in usually clinicians send a sepsis marker, send a paired blood cultures, procalcitonin and CRP. If everything is come negative after 48 hours, so definitely clinician has to stop the antibiotics or to be continue the same empirical antibiotics depending on the procalcitonin level. It will help in guiding as well as stopping the antibiotics. Now the third important thing is that now we have bought the film array, which is very, I think in Gujarat, I think 2 or 3 installation was there I was discussing. So we have a film array which we have initially just taken 4 months back, and we have started for the encephalitis. First I've started for the meningitis and encephalitis panels. Initially we are thinking that yes, that glucose is low, protein is high, the TLC is raised. Means all depends on the cell count and the protein level. But things are, when I realized that not everything is related to cell count. Yesterday, we have a patient of a doctor's son was having a lab report of glucose normal, protein normal, but the TLC was 1100, and there is a neutrophil predominance, and doctor started a ceftriaxone, and he is sure it is a pyogenic meningitis. But when we have done the encephalitis meningitis panel, it is came the enterovirus positive, and what we found is almost 4 months we have got 7 to 8 enteroviruses positive, which is common in pediatric age group. So then we realize that glucose is also coming normal, protein also. Then I have rechecked with the meningitis antigen panel, that also came negative. So things are changing. Clinicians may be showing, yes, there is no cell count, maybe you are getting cryptococcus meningitis. So it is not the same way around. And it's a very simple system. Within 1 hour you will get report. One day also, I informed the report to the clinicians, and clinician said, I got the report, it is a streptococcus pneumonia. I also suspecting clinician, but I have not received the cell count or glucose or biochemistry report of CSF cell count. Means within 1 or 2 hours, this is the time is 1 hour, and within 2 hours we report, but that time the cell count was not available to the clinicians. So how quick it is, you can understand, but the things it has to be utilized to the clinicians. This is a very simple cartridge where you will have extraction, multiplex PCR, everything in a one chip. You have to load the sample, bus, this much. Within 2 minutes, you just load the samples and you go away. After 1 hour come, you will get the results. Nothing, there is no need of science. The microbiology is needed, even pathologists can do, or clinician at bedside can do. These are some panels where it can identify a lot of organisms. Similarly, the encephalitis, meningitis, all viruses you can detect, which we initially don't have the platform to diagnose all these viruses, bacteria. And similarly, the respiratory pathogens, all viruses, bacteria, atypical pneumonia, we initially not able to diagnose. All can be diagnosed within 1 hour or maximum 2 hours of period. Sorry. Similarly, these are the GI panels, where stool samples, you can diagnose all these virus, astrovirus or adenovirus. All these viruses, even some like campylobacter or some organism we are not able to culture at all in the laboratory. In that case, even here also I'll tell you one short case where my son was having repeated diarrhea almost 12 to 14 times. Then I shown to the pediatricians and pediatrician told me, maybe it is a viral, but do a stool routine. So I went to the my lab, hardly 10 minutes away from my home. So I, in my microscopy, I found lot of pustules, almost 50 to 100 pustules. Then pediatrician told me, start antibiotics. Then I've started antibiotics also. But next day, next day morning, then I have this card. So when I run the card, it came astrovirus positive. So when I found the Google and found lot of astroviruses epidemic in UP and some other areas, then I stopped immediately the antibiotics. So, but it is not the bacteria where you will get lot of stool pustules, but in viruses, like especially astrovirus or norovirus, you will get lot of pustules. So lot of things are changing, and I hope the same will be applied, like at least, because most of the time the pathology is heading the laboratory. So if they have some interest on this, so at least help microbiologists to grow. And the same thing, most important thing, that they should come out, especially for microbiology, they should come out of the lab. They should go to the clinicians. They take the rounds or go to the patients and help the clinician to start antibiotics or whatever they require. Thank you. Thank you very much.